Alrighty. No more singing.
Let's hear it, Brian.
All right. I know what you're talking about.
Cool. So, seatbelt's fastened. Fuel shutoff valve is on.
Yeah, and go ahead and turn that guy off just so you get practice seeing what it feels like to turn it off.
It's just one?
The fuel shutoff. Just switch it and get it only rotates one way. Yep. So now you know what it looks like off. What it feels like off.
Yeah, it's a lot of resistance.
Yeah. They don't want you doing it on accident. Oh, let me turn the friction on.
Get out the way. There we go. All right.
Oh, God.
That works. All right. Cool. And then just to throttle in a second.
Okay, and I'm actually going to pull the Stroh breaker because we don't want that thing coming on.
Alrighty. So, cool. Collective check, cyclic check, pedal check. Rudder brake is disengaged. Circuit breakers are
all except for the Stroh.
All. There we go. Alright. Landing light is off. Avionics are all off. Clutch is disengaged. Altimeter will set and the governor switch is on and the hydraulic switch is
on your cyclic there.
On. Boom. Cool. Alright, so throttle closed. Do we need any primes in this bad boy?
Nope. Well, we'll prime it with the key, but like I said, we're just going to turn the battery on for a minute, and I'm going to show you the G500 and kind of what we're expecting to see.
Cool. All right. So, battery strobe switch is on.
We're just going to do the battery.
Master.
And now we're just going to wait for this thing to boot up. Satellite flash twice. We're good there. Carbon monoxide. All the lights we're expecting to see are on. The aux fuel pump, alternator, and oil light are on. This is waking up. So, here we go. So this is just all your databases and everything telling you when everything expires. Which, everything's already expired, but we're not actually flying IFR, so it's not an issue. So we'll sit, hit that key to wake it up.
Which one?
I already hit it. It just says, like, press this soft key to continue.
Gotcha.
So this is going to be your PFD, Primary Flight Display, and it's AHAR is this Attitude Heading Reference System. It's laser gyros, basically. So right now, it's just kind of finding where level is. So on this side, you're going to have your airspeed. Here is going to be your attitude indicator.
Mm-hmm.
Brown is the ground, and blue is the sky. And then up here, you've got, this will tell you, it's part of your attitude indicator, but that tells you what your angle of bank is. So, let me get this off one bit. So this little triangle right here is going to move right and left along that little curve.
Mm-hmm.
So right there, that line is 10 degrees of bank. 20 degrees, 30 degrees, 45, and I think 60. Same thing on the other side.
Wow.
And we're going to do what's called a standard rate turn whenever we're flying. And that's going to give us a rate of 3 degrees per second.
And I'm going to pull the caution lights so we're not burning a bunch of power. If I can remember where they are. There we go. Pull text.
Alright, so like I said, standard rate turn is going to be 3 degrees of turning per second. So right now we're on a heading 289.
Mm-hmm.
If we were in a standard rate turn for 10 seconds, we would be 30 degrees one way or the other. So that would be
319.
Yeah. I'm glad you're faster at this than I am. So that's going to be our standard rate turn. And when we're at 90 knots, 15 degrees of bank will give us a standard rate turn.
I see.
So whenever I say standard rate, that's what we're looking for, is at 90 degrees, or at 90 knots, we're about 15 degrees in bank.
So, it was 15, 30, what were these ones right here?
So it's 10, 20, 30, 45, and 60.
Okay.
Really, the important things are these three. The first three 10, are 20, 10 degrees 30. Each. Yeah, and then you go by 15s.
Okay.
So that's going to be our standard rate turn. It is a slow turn. It takes a long time to get there. You can also tell you're in a standard rate turn. When you're turning, there's a little this color magenta bar that'll come out from right here. If you hit that first line right there, that's half standard rate, so 1.5 degrees per second. You hit that second line, that's your standard rate, 3 degrees per second. That's your trend indicator, your rate of turn indicator. So if we're not at 90 knots, then you know maybe we're at 70 knots. Maybe go for like 10 degrees of bank. And then if that guy comes out and doesn't quite reach, you know, gets maybe right halfway in between, just go a little bit more, just a tiny little bit. There he's going somewhere. This is going to be our altimeter here. We have altitude bugs and heading bugs. We also have vertical speed bugs, but I don't like to use those. So to change our heading bug, when you don't see anything displayed right here, just twist the knob. Now it pops up heading. It says, okay, you can set it to, so if I say turn right heading 220, you're going to twist this guy till that says 220, and then you'll start your standard rate turn until your heading is on that. Yeah, and then once that goes away, it's done. If you want to set, say, the altitude bug, click on the altitude, it pops up altitude, and then you can scroll and it goes by hundreds of feet.
I see. So these heading, altitude.
Yeah, course we'll get into later. VS is vertical speed. I usually just leave it at zero because it moves that little bug around there. It bugs me if it's not at zero for some reason. And then barrel is how you set your altimeter. So just kind of set that. And you can watch it actually change. Probably going to be somewhere around there. 299 or 1-ish. That's about what our standard altimeter is reading. Vertical speed indicator is here. Nothing crazy there. It's in thousands of feet per minute, so it'll go 0.1, 0.2, 0.3 all the way up to 1.
Mm-hmm.
Then it goes 1.1, 1.2.
And so this is thousands of feet, right?
Yeah. Yeah, these are going to be thousands of feet per minute. And then we've got, this is called the HSI. For right now, it's the magnetic compass. That's all you need to know about it.
Mm-hmm.
It should be more or less aligned with this, but it's kind of not. So that's interesting. But, you know, we're expecting this to be, we're going to use this for our navigation for right now.
Mm-hmm.
So when I say turn right heading 300, clicking this in will bring the heading bug to whatever you're at right now. And then you can just go over to 300.
I see.
And then you'll start your turn.
Oh, that's nice. It's a little reset.
Yep. And then the same works for altitude as well. If you hit the altitude button and then click it in, it'll go to the nearest hundreds of feet that we're currently at. So that's how you can quick set an altitude bug and a heading bug too. And then, like I said, when there's nothing there and it goes away, it defaults to heading when you hit the knob again.
Okay.
All right, so that's our HSI.
Where's it getting information from? Wind data, all that shit?
It's hooked up because we got the airspeed indicator here. It's got an air data computer, so it's hooked up to the pedo tube, and it's got all the information it needs.
Oh, I see.
Coming through there.
So it calculates it based on GPS and airspeed.
Yeah, it'll put our ground speed up there because we have the GPS off right now.
Because
we have it on for the moment. We're not getting any ground speed information. We don't have a waypoint plugged in, so we don't have any of this information up here.
And so it also does the true airspeed calculation for us and ground speed?
Yeah, but the air data computer needs to be recalibrated, so don't trust this too much until Cody gets a chance to fix it. So that's kind of the basic layout of our glass panel here. As far as scanning goes, my preferred scan is boom, 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 boom. And then here, and then you start over. So it's kind of like just a lazy circle. You really don't want to spend more than about a second on each instrument. If you start fixating on something, I'll be able to tell because everything else is going to start to go to shit. And if you're omitting something, I'll probably be able to tell as well because everything, you know, there'll be one thing that's totally going to shit.
Yeah.
So you'll hear me constantly say, keep scanning, keep scanning, keep the scan going, scanning.
But this is basically all I'll have, right?
Yeah, and every...
I'm not going to be able to look outside, so...
Right, yeah, you'll have the instrument panel here, and that's going to be it. So,
So this notably doesn't have... So, it's got an altimeter, right? It's got, basically, airspeed. But it doesn't have manifold pressure, and it doesn't have tech.
Right, so you'll every so often keep these guys in your scan, keep your gauges in your scan, all your lights, because, you know, you're flying instruments, you want to know if you get a chip light or something like that coming on. So
yeah.
You do have to keep these guys in your scan. Not every single time you scan the instruments, but, you know, every so often.
Yeah.
So that's the first of the three basic skills of instrument flying is instrument interpretation, or no, instrument cross-check, which is basically looking at your instruments. The next is instrument interpretation. So we're looking at our attitude indicator here, for instance, and this is saying that we're nose level because that ball is sitting pretty much right on the horizon.
Yeah.
When we push forward cyclic, that thing's going to come down relative to the brown line.
So you'll see, like, somewhere up here?
Yeah, the horizon line will come up like that.
Okay.
If you get really steep, then you'll see red arrows down here that are saying, hey, you're getting really steep. But we're probably not going to get too wonky today. Well, I don't know. We might. It'd be interesting to see. So the things that will tell us that we're in a nose-down attitude are going to be, obviously, the attitude indicator will show a more nose-down attitude. When we're flying, it's going to be a little bit nose-down just because that's the way helicopters gain forward airspeed.
Yeah.
So it's going to have a little bit of nose-down, but if you look up there and it's at like 10 degrees nose down, you can bet we're going to start descending. Other ways we can tell we're in a nose down attitude are altitude decreasing, showing a descent on our VSI, airspeed increasing. Everything we're going to do is going to be as close to 90 knots as we can get it.
Okay.
And we'll talk about why at some other point.
90 knot ground speed or?
Airspeed.
Airspeed?
Yeah, just indicated airspeed.
So where is indicated airspeed on this guy?
It'll be this right here. Oh. These numbers, it's this little tape will scroll down. Kind of like the altimeter does.
So this is not ground speed?
No, ground speed will just be a readout up here.
Oh,
it'll, just,
okay.
It'll just be
the
a
meter,
number.
The meters indicate it, true
yep.
air speed, and then ground speed is a number up here, which I guess it's X'd out because it's not...
Because we don't have the GPS on.
Oh, okay.
It's saying you don't have ground speed information right now.
Gotcha.
So that's how we can tell we're in a nose-down attitude. If we're in a nose-up attitude, we're going to expect to see the opposite. Our little dot's going to come up into the blue. We're going to see an increase in on our altimeter, climb on our VSI, and decreasing airspeed. When you make corrections for things, they always have to be really, really small. And you have to make the input and then wait. The first thing you're going to notice when you make an attitude change is going to be on the attitude indicator. That's going to be the first thing that moves. Then you're going to start to notice a change on the altimeter and the VSI kind of around the same time. The VSI might be a little bit faster, and then you'll start to see a change in the airspeed. So as soon as you see a change in here that you don't like, you know, maybe your attitude is sitting where kind of where you are expecting it to sit, but your airspeed or your altimeter is starting to show a descent,
mm-hmm.
you know that we've come nose down. So before we even complete our scan and look over here, you can just the tiniest, you know, that much aft and kind of see what it does.
Yeah.
As you'll see, this thing is very, very sensitive, especially when you're under the hood. So, let's see. That's our instrument interpretation, is what are these telling you? You'll know you're in a turn and you don't want to be if this guy is not sitting right under center, or you've got this is spinning around in a circle.
So this right here, the diamond pointing up
uh-huh.
is or triangle. That's the turn indicator, and then this is the trim, right?
Yes. And on this, you step on the bar. So in this case, we would step on right pedal.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's how our instrument interpretation works. And then the third fundamental skill of instrument flying is aircraft control, which means making the aircraft do what you want it to do based on what the instruments are telling you is happening. And this gets difficult because when you're under the hood and this is all you can see, you'll start to feel, especially when it's kind of windy like this, spatial disorientation. It'll feel like you're going nose up and losing all your airspeed. You'll want to punch forward, but you'll look and we'll be at 110 knots.
Yeah.
So you know that your body's lying to you. The solution to most questions about spatial disorientation on the written test is going to be trust your instruments. So even if you feel like we're descending and in a right turn, if this shows that we're straight and level, don't make any changes because we're
yeah.
straight and level. And like I said, it is all very sensitive to, you know, whatever input. We'll basically just go, it's probably going to be about 21 inches and straight and level will give us 90 knots in airspeed. And we'll get going.
How many? 21 or 22?
We'll see. It might be 21, it might be 22. I'm not really sure. We'll get going here in a second.
I guess
Yeah, so I mean that's kind of the basics of instrument flying is keep your constant scan, and whatever scan pattern works best for you is the best scan pattern, you know. For me, I like the kind of lazy circle. For you, it might be, you know, you look, yeah, exactly. You might be kind of all over the place. So the first couple lessons are really just about you figuring out what scan works for you and learning how to control the helicopter.
Yeah. I guess it's different because your scan doesn't include outside, right?
Yep, that's my job to look outside. So, and I'll do the radios today so you can just kind of focus on this.
Okay.
So, yeah, basically I'm just going to keep saying, keep scanning. And I'll probably say little inputs a lot of the time as well, because a lot of people like to make really big inputs in here. Okay. Any questions before we fire up here and get on the go?
Not too much. So this is where I'm basically living and then checking these guys as well.
Maybe every 5 to 10 scans of this, you'll come out here and check everything real quick.
Okay. Yeah, and so you'll give me the settings to maintain, and then I'll likely struggle to maintain them, but that's the goal, huh?
Yep. As expected.
All right. Yeah, this will be interesting. I don't know what to expect.
Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna put all our breakers back in. Alrighty.
Clear.
Clear.
Okay, now we can continue on our checklist.
All right. So we are area clear, so we're at the mixture, and we do this kind of weird thing, right?
Yeah, so first we're going to prime it, so go ahead and push mixture full rich.
Alright, so mixture full rich.
And then you can leave that off because we're going to pull it out again.
Cool.
And then that's a momentary switch to the prime. And it's, you know, just like the R22, except it's prime instead of start. You're not actually doing anything unless the aux fuel pump light goes out.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll give it maybe a half a second of prime, and you can go ahead and do that now. And like I said, what?
So hold it for half a second?
Hold it so that this is out for half a second.
Okay.
That's it. Perfect. Now we're going to go lean.
Full lean?
Yeah. That's right. Okay, so now we've got our starter here. So with your left hand on the throttle, throttle's closed. We're going to crank the starter.
And once I hear it,
yeah, once it starts to catch, you can go about 1,001, a nice slow one count to bring it in.
Whoa,
we're going to be landing on that pad right there, so we'll wait till they get on the ground.
Great. So wait to start it up?
Yeah. Because otherwise, our blades are going to be spinning, and they're going to be throwing a whole bunch of air underneath it, and that's how you can't tail.
Forgetting how much I hate this headset.
forgetting to get my own and change it out with the one that doesn't suck ass.
Alright. So, phone 190, anything important?
No, I don't remember what that is.
Do we get, we have a comm 2 on this, right? So.
Yeah, so we'll just wake this guy up. So here's your database expiration page. So again, we're not going to fly actual IFR, so we don't really worry that it's expired by now. So this is something that we will use though. This we can go up to 65% now that our clutch light's out. So this page is an instrument self-check. So the 430 and the G500 are hooked up together. So this says LCDI, which is your lateral course deviation indicator. This magenta arrow here, it's halfway to the left. And it's halfway to the left because it's pointing that way is forward in its mind. So it's halfway off to its left side.
Uh-huh.
Then we have lateral flags out of view. So it doesn't say, I forget what the wording is gonna be, but it says like LOI or loss of integrity or something like that. BCDI is vertical CDI. And that's that guy, and it's halfway up. That's our glide slope. Then VFLG is vertical flag, and again, it doesn't say LOI or anything like that. I think that's the phraseology it uses. To from indicator, we have two arrows are pointing in the same direction. That means two. RMI is 135. That's going to be our little diamond right there. OBS is 150. The arrow itself is pointing at 150, so that checks out. Annunciator is on, and DTK is 150 up there. GTK 150. So now we can go hit enter one more time down there, and that'll start acquiring satellites for us. Okay, now we can get our ATIS as well.
Cool, so it's being in there, so.
Yeah, so it's already in there. So to listen to COM 2, we have to hit that button.
There we go, COM 2.
Wind 26013, gust 23.
Oh, and here.
Visibility 10.
Yeah, that's
good. Ignition 700 scattered, temperature 17. 2.13, altimeter 2999.
Foggles are going to be right down here in front of the radio.
Left in use. Landing and departing runway is 28.
Was it 2991?
No, yeah. Chairman. No Oakland Northfield transitions due to a TFR in effect until further notice. Unable pattern work on runway 28 left or runway 28 right. Obstruction tower light 1.6 nautical miles south southwest of Harrod Airport, 230 feet AGL out of service. Attentional aircraft, hazardous weather information for Northern California and coastal waters available on high-loss or flight service frequencies. Advise on initial contact, you have information, Kilo.
Kilo. Oh, I guess Zulu's back.
Okay, airport information, Kilo. 0154
yeah,
Zulu.
You can go ahead and turn that off here already. I'm just going to fire it in here. All right, and the G500 automatically, see, you can look at the moving map here, it automatically pushes it in here for us. Sequences it into the GPS, so we don't have to do any thinking.
Nice. All right. So.
Okay, so let's see. Now we'll just kind of continue our run up as normal.
We're not quite green yet here.
That's close enough.
All right.
So go up to 75.
75. Let's see, where are we? Okay, so engine gauge is green. Okay, so that's 75. Bring it up slightly. Governor takes over at 80 here too, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, a lot of the stuff is the same as the R22. There's not a whole lot different.
Slightly. Alright, so same thing, 7% max in 2 seconds. 1-1000, 2-1000, good. Get back up. Check the right. 1-1000, 2-1000, good. Alright, and then split the needles, which don't
yeah, and bring it right up to 80% and then bring it right back off. There you go. Yeah, and even then, here, I'm gonna just, can I get it? Yeah, there's a little bit of split. These don't really split very well, especially if it's warm out, they won't split very well. I'm surprised we didn't get that much out of it right now.
All right, so doors closed and latched. Temperature is 19, so we are 229er, and that makes it 5-7.
Cool.
All right, so take the frictions off, check the hydraulic system, and then check the horn.
All right.
So friction off.
And then we'll pick up into a hover and step out kind of that way, and we'll do the instrument checks before we take off.
All right, so how do I test hydraulics again?
So run it up to about 75. Okay, now we're gonna look up at the disc. We can see the blades and just move a little bit forward, a little bit aft. We can see the blades are actually moving. We can feel the hydraulics are working.
Yeah.
Go ahead and switch them off. Now forward. Yeah, it takes a little bit more work. And back, and we can see that they are moving and we can feel the hydraulics are not working.
Yep.
So now take all pressure off of it so that you don't accidentally shove it forward and switch the hydraulics back on. There you go. And now make sure they're back on. So it's forward and aft. Perfect.
All right.
Okay. Let's switch these guys on so that we're extra visible. And we'll go ahead and...
take our low RPM horn.
Yeah.
Roll it up.
80%. Wait for that guy to go out. There we go.
All right, so roll it down to 97. There it is. All right.
Okay, clear left.
Clear right, except for these two blokes.
Yeah, so we'll, let's go behind him. No, let's go in front of him.
Okay.
A little less space, but then we're not trying to go backwards into the blind.
Cool, so the two-stage pickup's the same thing, right? 17, go outside.
Yep.
It starts to get light somewhere around 20.
Yeah, with the two of us, it might be a little sooner, but we'll see.
Okay.
You load this thing up and you're at like 22 inches and barely getting light and you're like, holy shit.
Let's watch what these guys are doing.
Yeah, we'll keep an eye on them. Maybe we will go behind if they're going to be...
Confrontation 44 Charlie Juliet is APP with Kilo right there.
Confrontation 448 Charlie Juliet, A word ground. Initiate left, exit Alpha Alpha 1.
Turn left Alpha Alpha 1, 8 Charlie Juliet.
Just because we're close to a bunch of expensive shit here, I'm going to be real close on the controls. Going up. There we go. That's all right.
All right.
Okay. All right, so let's go ahead and... yeah, we got enough clearance behind him.
Which way?
Let's go behind him. Tail's clear to the left.
Alright, so just back it up.
Yeah. Alright, right about there, we'll make a pedal turn. Nice and slowly. And now we'll go right out away from everybody here. Okay, so while we're taxiing out here, we can kind of check some of our instruments to make sure that they're working. So right now, we know that our altimeter is showing basically at sea level. So we can check that by raising collective and making sure we get a climb on the altimeter and VSI. So we'll go ahead and come to about a 10-foot hover. There we are. Altimeter and VSI show a climb. We'll hold right there. Now we're going to do the drunken pilot checks, and those are to check that our attitude indicator is working properly. So to do that, we're just going to watch the attitude indicator and kind of fore and aft, left and right, to get a little indication on the attitude indicator there. Then we'll bring our collective back down to about a 3-foot hover, and we get a descent on the vertical speed and altimeter. And we want to keep that nice new low hover.
All right.
And as we're turning around, we can watch our HSI. That guy should show more or less what the compass shows and should indicate as we turn that we're turning. All right, so that's just about it. As we take off, we'll check that our airspeed indicator is working properly on both here and the analog, and that our altimeter works correctly as well.
All right.
So whenever you're ready, we can call up and do a
right
cross and departure.
All right. Are you making the calls or am I making the call?
Juliet, hey,
what's the ATIS we have again?
Kilo.
Okay. I'll give him a call. Hey, we're Tower Hill, got a 63 Bravo Kilo, is it Meridian with Kilo, like right cross on departure.
Tower 63 Bravo Kilo, hey, we're Tower right cross departure approved, wind 240 at 1-1, taxiway Zulu clear for takeoff.
Taxiway Zulu clear for takeoff, right cross on departure approved, 63 Bravo Kilo.
Yeah, it's quiet here today.
Yeah. I think between the wind and the recent events. We don't need any more power than we did the hover. Let our nose come up. Yeah, we're gonna get fucking rocked. So we can be good.
Station and Charlie Julia, continue holding. All expect right. Less than 5 minutes.
Take a look there.
Hey, Charlie.
Yeah, we could turn right over the golf course.
Alright.
Yeah, that's where it was.
Alrighty.
Yeah, it got low over there.
Didn't give us below 1,500.
He did not, crosses. You know, he didn't really give us anything, but, Hey, we're Tower 63 Bravo Kilo, do you want us to east of three crosses, or can we go a little bit more to the left?
63 Bravo Kilo, remain clear of the Charlie airspace, and, you can presume that, resume at your own navigation.
Okay, own nav outside of the Charlie, 63 Bravo Kilo, thanks. Let's go a little bit to the left there. Kind of towards Mount Diablo, so we'll jump out underneath the clouds here. Then once we get out from underneath the clouds, we'll have you put the foggles on. Climb up a little bit.
Oh man, alright.
Yeah, it looks like this actually is going to blow through and then it should be clear again for a while at Hayward, so that's good.
Yeah. I guess we could also duck over Sinol if we wanted to.
Yeah, I mean, if worse comes to worse, we can just get back in through there because Niles Canyon is a little bit lower altitude.
Alright. Maybe just right through this little gap right there to Lake Chabot.
Yeah, that works for me. So in a minute here, I'm going to take controls and you can go ahead and put the foggles on.
Yeah, buddy.
I put them right down there underneath your legs in front of the marine radio.
Alright.
I'm going to... Basically, when I'm on the controls, I don't really do much. I just kind of act as an autopilot. So I'll let you kind of set a heading and an altitude, and then whatever you're doing, I'll just hold it.
Okay.
Unless we need to climb or something like that. You know, if we get an ATC instruction while you're putting the foggles on, I'll comply with it.
All right.
But for the most part, it's kind of whatever you're at is where I'm going to keep you.
Yeah. And this is so much more of a... steady aircraft in the 22.
Yeah.
22, you're getting rocked around and shit, this one.
Yeah.
Holds ground a little bit better.
Yeah, this is saying a 19 knot crosswind tailwind component here, so.
Alright, so got wires up there, it looks
like. Attention all across formation, Lima, current wind 24010, altimeter 2991, ceiling 1000 broken.
Alright, my controls.
Your controls.
I got them.
Alright, foggle timer.
Yep.
Wires, huh?
Yeah, and I'm just gonna kinda keep climbing us out of here as you get those things on, and then we'll get started with the fun stuff.
Alright.
Alright, your controls.
My controls.
You got them. So, I want you to, let's climb at 80 knots is good. That's good, that's a good climb. Our power is right where we want it. Let's climb to, let's go to 3,000.
3,000?
Yeah.
Alright.
And, let's go a little bit more to the left. Let's go a heading of 330.
330?
There. So a little bit to the left.
To the left, the other left.
Yeah, just trying to dodge one cloud out here and then we can play around.
Might have you take these again, take the controls in a second so I can put my glasses back on.
Okay. There's our heading, so now we're gonna start our rollout.
Alright, maybe bring the speed back a little bit.
So when we're rolling out of a turn, you want to start to level the cyclic out about 5 degrees before the heading that you want.
Yeah.
So if we were making a left turn to 330, when it says 335, that's when you want to start bringing it nice and gently back to center.
Man, this is nuts.
Yeah. So just remember, we're scanning everything continuously. And let's go ahead and turn right heading 030.
All right, zero.
So I'll work the heading bug for you today just because it's day one.
All right, we want to bring our speed back down so we can climb.
Yeah.
Zero. Oh man, dude, I am disoriented.
Yeah. Remember, just trust your instruments.
Yeah.
There's your nice standard rate turn. Look at that. Yeah, right on 15 degrees for a second there.
All right, so 03. Wow, this is crazy, man.
Yeah, and just remember, it's all about small inputs. There we go. Now let's keep the turn coming to 060 so we don't run into the mountain.
Okay.
Mountain.
Yeah, got Charlie Juliet, change course heading to turn left heading 130, runway 28 left, clear for takeoff.
130 now, for departure, 28 left, clear for takeoff, Charlie Juliet.
All right,
there you go. There's our heading. So we're just continuing to scan everything. No crazy wild inputs. We got our speed that we want. If you're within a couple knots of your airspeed, you don't need to make a really much of a correction. If you want, you can think about pulling aft cyclic. That's usually enough to get the cyclic to where you want it to go.
Yeah.
Just thinking about it usually does the trick.
Oop, maybe it's turning a little bit too much here. Oh. Jesus Christ, dude, I feel like I'm drunk. Oh man.
Alright. Bon cruising out of here.
So let's see, stomp on the pedal. Oop. Hope this is fun for you.
Yeah.
It's like
teaching someone how to fly straight level for the first time, only they already know how to fly. So they're like, why can't I do this? So we'll just climb up to 3,000 feet. So because we're at about 80 knots and about a 400 foot per minute climb, I have a feeling that when we level out, if we just use cyclic to go forward, yeah, just use cyclic and don't adjust our power, we're gonna go a little bit too fast. But let's give it a shot and see what happens when we get there. So we got another 300 feet to go.
We're going to 3,000?
Yeah. Yeah, I put our little bug up there. And so, with turns, we have our 5 degrees early rule of thumb. With altitude changes,
Charlie, you have contact North Approach today.
We're outside of
Charlie.
With altitude changes, you usually take about 10% of your vertical speed. That's how early you want to level out. So
yeah.
Let's say we're at a 500 foot per minute climb. About 50 feet early, we want to start either lowering collective or nosing forward or both to bring our climb rate under control.
All right, so you're right here. Whoop.
Yeah, now we're gonna start getting punched around by turbulence.
All right.
So we can even go to 4,000.
Okay.
Hopefully that'll get us a little bit above it.
All right, just keep our airspeed up.
Yeah.
Okay, so 22, the collective on this guy stays pretty steady.
Yeah.
Yeah, Juliet, Bravo.
All right, so here we go. Settings look good.
There we go. Now we're holding a nice climb rate. We got a nice heading. Getting a little scan action going on. All right, let's turn right heading zero. So actually, before we do that, when I have you do like heading changes and stuff, I'm gonna pretend to be air traffic control. So I'll say helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo, turn right heading such and such. You'll say right such and such, helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo. Then you'll make your heading bug change, then you'll make your turn.
All right.
Do that to practice flying vectors in real life under actual IFR, because that's what it's gonna sound like. So let me get us on with Livermore here.
Okay.
Livermore Tower, helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo is about 10 miles to the west-northwest at 3,700, climbing to 4,000, and we might just poke into your airspace a little bit. We're gonna be transitioning eastbound here.
Helicopter 6 Bravo Kilo, Livermore Tower, roger, transition delta at or above 2,000. It's proved the Livermore altimeter is 2988.
2988 and at or above 2,000 for 63 Bravo Kilo, thanks. Okay, 2988. All right, helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo, turn right heading 090.
090, 63 Bravo Kilo. Okay. 090, so.
Yep, so now there you go, left hand comes off.
Let's see.
And there you go.
90, and I don't have to punch it in, right?
Correct, yeah, just leave it right there, and now eventually that'll go away, but the heading bug will stay where it's at.
This is 6 Mike Delta, stay parked.
All right.
6 Mike Delta, turn right on Delta, and then Juliet to Bay Area Flight Club. 05.
So this thing has the floats on the skids, which produce a whole bunch of drag, so that's probably why we're only getting, you know, 90 knots, 22 inches here. So. Alright, and this is wild. Wow, there's our 4,000.
Hold it short, 25 right for right close traffic.
I nose forward a little bit.
Yeah.
Baron
31
Echo,
ready
to go?
Hey, ready to go, right close traffic.
Baron 31 Echo, make right close traffic, runway 25 right, clear for takeoff, wind 2404.
A little harder than I thought to keep the heading.
Baron 31 Echo.
Yeah, and you can use this guy, because remember, if those two triangles are lined up, we're wings level, so we shouldn't really have much heading change at all.
Yeah. Man, the VSI is a little sensitive, it feels like, or am I just slowing down?
Well, we lost 10 knots and we're climbing at 500 feet per minute, so.
Who knows for?
Pretty accurate. I think it just looks more sensitive because it's not a dial moving around.
Yeah.
It's a number that's directly reading off how much we're changing. All right, helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo, turn right heading 120.
Right heading 120, 63 Bravo Kilo.
The faster you turn it, the more degrees it'll turn over per click. So if you gotta make like a 180 degree turn,
yeah,
spin it real fast and it'll go like 3 or 4 degrees per click.
All right, so my standard turn right there. A little bit more here. There we go. Too much. Too much the other way.
Yep. Just remember, keep that scan. Don't fixate on any one thing.
260 at 5, altimeter 2988.
Yeah, you're right. I'm fixating on the other stuff and my heading is just kind of wonky.
You should only spend a beat on each instrument.
Those should be
boom. You're really just looking for trends. If you notice that this is trending up or down, you know you make some kind of adjustment. If this is trending up or down, that's trending left or right, up or down, left or right,
yeah,
then you know you need to make some kind of adjustment. So we're off by about 300 feet here, so instead of just using airspeed to get it back, I want to lower collective a little bit. And we want to get that altitude back.
Okay.
Anytime you're off by more than about 100 feet on altitude, you want to use collective to get it back.
Okay.
Anything less than 100 feet, and we'll just gain or lose just a few knots of airspeed to control altitude.
Yeah.
And then anytime we're climbing or descending, we want to be about 500 feet per minute. That's the minimum IFR climb and descent speed.
Really?
Yeah. So that's what they're expecting you to
number
do.
Two following a Cessna
so get that descent or climb in, huh?
I'm looking for the Cessna right, number two there? For 25 right, clear the option, 318.
Yeah, the closer to actually being 500, the happier we are. I mean, if you're at 600 or 400, that's okay too, but you know, if you're at 200, they're gonna start worrying about you.
Yeah, alright, so start bringing the collective back in.
Yeah. And remember, as we raise collective, our nose will come up, harkening all the way back to our intro flight days where we kind of play with just the collective and see what happens.
No contact on the Cessna, if you can call our base, please.
Yeah, look at 63 Bravo Kilo, turn left heading 04, let's go 050.
Left heading 050.
I didn't see him now, 31 Echo, thank you.
As you turn, watch the attitude indicator, and if that dot comes up, then we know that we're going to start climbing. If it goes down, and we're already a little bit high, so that's okay, it came down, we know that we're going to start descending. That's kind of part of the cross-check part. All right, so aircraft control.
Bander turn.
Don't fixate.
Climbing again, so slower collective, a little bit of forward.
Yeah, so our altitude is too high and our airspeed is too low. So there's one, we can make one control input that will fix both of those.
Yep.
That's forward second. So we go ahead and do that. And because we're over 100 feet off, like you said, we'll lower collective. All right, let's descend and maintain 3,000.
All right.
So we'll go for 90 knots and I don't know, actually 18 inches will probably do it for us.
All right.
Another little rule of thumb we have is let's say that 22 inches at straight and level gets us 90 knots. If we raise the collective 3 inches to 25, we should get 90 knots on a 500 foot per minute climb, more or less.
Caution, if we lower it, activity over the approach in 25 right.
If we lower it 3 inches, then we should get more or less a 500 foot per minute rate of descent. So let's go ahead and put our altitude bug down on 3,000.
All right. So altitude.
Yep. And then that goes in hundreds of feet. There you go. Perfect. And then we just leave it right there, and it'll stay.
A little bit forward airspeed here. Back on course.
All right, let me get Byron's information up in the radios here.
I'm gonna do a blind approach.
I'll kind of vector you up with the runway and I'll let you come out for the
shot. I'm gonna go left close traffic 1-4 minutes though. Still looking for the helicopter. Vehicle traffic, helicopter 2 Romeo Juliet, we're about 2 miles to the south, northwest down at 1,000 feet, you know we're looking for you. You're gonna make left.
And
traffic.
Let's continue our descent down to 2,000 feet.
Traffic and I have you in sight.
2,000 feet.
Copy, we got you as well.
Great, remarks, density altitude 1,200. Byron Airport, automated weather observation 0305 Zulu. Wind 210 at 27 knots. Peak gusts 33 knots. Visibility 9er. Sky condition clear below 12,000. Temperature 22 Celsius. Dew point 1 9er 81 inches of mercury. Remark. Density altitude 1,200.
That's low. All right.
Get our descent going more.
So what is it? 27 gusting to 33.
Yeah.
This will be fun. That's only what is it? 7 knot. 6 knot gust spread.
Yep. All right. So altitude. Put that down to 2,000.
Micro traffic helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo is approximately 4 miles to the south southeast of San Diego. 2600 going to set up for a touch and go 25. Micro. It's 25. That was 23. Damn. I'll get it next time.
Or we could still do 25. Make a run.
All right, helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo, turn left heading 030.
Left heading 030. Oops. 030, yeah, there we go.
And we can keep our 90 knots.
Razor Travis Scout, 446 off Fox Shot, turning left base 14, still have the helicopter traffic in sight, no factor.
And with this hill going down, it looks like we have an aggressive nose down attitude. I have no idea. I guess trusting the instruments, I shouldn't, but
yeah,
deceptive.
Gotta trust these guys. A little bit quieter with that close. I'm just gonna turn the air on.
All right.
Okay, we'll level off at 2,000 feet per minute, and I'll give us a turn.
A little too much there.
So really, the helicopter doesn't care so much how strong the wind is. A 6 knot gust spread is not really a lot.
Yeah.
If it's, you know, if it's this strong wind and a big gust spread, that's something that I'm kind of worried about. But
yeah,
you know, this, I'm not super worried about a 6 knot gust spread. But you know, we might get down there and it's way more than that, and then we'll make the decision when we get there.
Yeah.
All right, let's turn left heading 300.
300. Maintain 2,000?
We can come down to 1,000.
Alrighty. Heading. Keep our speed up.
Yeah, we got a little slow there.
Put our manifold pressure down. All right. A little bit of right pedal.
Yeah, I want just 500 feet per minute.
500, all right, there we go. Bit more. Yeah, you're right about looking for trends. And
yeah. All right, I got a 63 Bravo Kilo, turn right heading 345.
Right heading 345, 63 Bravo Kilo. That's not gonna mess with the bug. You always use the bug, or?
Yep.
Always?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because one of these days you're gonna be hit vectored and you're gonna forget what your heading is supposed to be, and you're gonna be 30 degrees off, and ATC is gonna be pissed.
Alrighty, 345.
Here's a traffic scout, 446 off Foxtrot, 700 feet on the upwind, left crosswind.
There you go, collective.
Okay, let's go like 18 inches. We were 1100 foot per minute descent there. It's a little more than we need, especially with this strong wind.
Nope, too much. Three, four, five, right about there. And we're climbing, we don't want to climb. Got about 18 inches there, so let's bring our speed up. And water, where the hell are we?
There's a lake out here, or a, probably a reservoir. You thought we were going to Byron. We're out over the ocean. All right, let's turn left heading 230.
All right, left heading 230, 63 Bravo Kilo. 230.
230. Getting this lined up with our rough air. If we keep the descent coming down, about like 500.
Okay.
Yeah, once we get out of here, we'll go over and buzz around over top of Livermore again, because it's a lot smoother out there. That nice standard rate turn for me.
There we go, right about there.
We'll do a short approach.
A little bumpy out here.
Yeah. Byron traffic, helicopter 63 Bravo Kilos, 2 mile final 2-3 descending on 900 feet, Byron. Okay, and watch that attitude indicator, because that's a big nose down there.
500 feet?
Yeah. And once we hit there, I'll have you come out of the foggles. Do our touch and go, and we'll be on our way.
Alright.
That speed right around 90 for me. Bring it up a little. Alright, my controls.
Your controls?
I got them.
Alrighty. Oh shit, where'd we go? Alright.
Hey, your controls.
My controls.
You got them.
Oh shit, this is a whole new ballgame.
Yeah, it's weird, isn't it?
Yeah, alright.
So we can just keep it nice and quick. Because we're doing 54 fucking knots over the ground at 82 knots airspeed.
Wow.
That's a good 30 knots.
Where's the sock?
I don't remember. It's on the other side of the hangar there, I think.
Convenient location.
Right. You can see it from exactly half of the airport.
Man, this is so much more fun.
Looking outside when you fly?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Having reference. Alright, so let's slow it down. And
we can even come to a hover if you want to and kind of see what it feels like at 30 knots. You know, having ETL at a hover is fun. Yeah,
we almost don't have to worry about ETL here, right?
Yeah, let's not go any lower than 15 inches, though.
Okay.
Because in this kind of wind, one good gust will balloon your RPM super hard if you're low manifold pressure, low flat pitch. Yeah, so now we can just kind of leave collector right where it's at and just start bleeding off airspeed.
Pushed around here. Bring it forward, bring it forward. There we go.
Alright, all right, check it out. We're hovering at 12 feet AGL at 18 and a half inches.
Wow.
Alright, whenever you're ready, we can rock and roll.
Alright, so lights are out, gauges are green. No carb heat. Alright, here we go.
Byron traffic, helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo departing 2-3 straight out to Byron. That was difficult for me. I'm not sure why.
Alright, so there's our 55. I'll try the foggles with my glasses this time.
Okay. Once we hit 500 feet, I'll put you under again. Yeah, we'll just keep our airspeed nice and low, no more than 60 in this shit. We can even turn out to the right if you want.
Yeah, get out for these.
Yeah, because the closer we are to the lee side of this hill, the more we're going to get bumped around. But there you go. That's your 30 knot landing.
That wasn't so bad.
Yeah.
Well, the wind didn't feel bad. It was just getting down on that descent was actually kind of tough.
Yeah.
Is that typical?
Yeah.
If it's real windy, it's hard to...
Yeah, well, the R44 doesn't like to descend and decelerate at the same time. So anytime you're trying to do both of those things, you're going to have a hard time. That's why I always try to get people to like lower the collective before you need it down.
Yeah.
That's a nice crab angle, isn't it?
Yeah, jeez.
All right, my controls.
Your controls.
I got them.
All right, here we go. See you later, world. All right, this is a little bit better. All right, I have the controls.
You have controls. All right, let's 240 on the heading, and we'll climb to, we'll go back at the 3,000. I'll just get our bug set there, because that was kind of nice. All right, nice and smooth. Don't run them. I don't know if the elbow's up that way. What time did you say you had to be done by?
Don't particularly.
Okay.
Oh. We got our climb going. Got manifold pressure, so now we're just really balancing here. And now coming back under here, this is like I was kind of getting used to it.
Yeah.
Then you gave me my freedom. Kind of a wacky idea. It's like, hey, why don't we just fly this fucker blind?
Yeah.
Alright. Let's get our attitude back down.
We can keep 60 knots to climb.
Okay. We're at 240. It doesn't seem like it wants to get over there. Maybe the wind. Okay, there we go.
Yeah, so now that we have our heading, anytime you see those triangles depart from each other, you know that we're going to have to make some kind of adjustment.
Alright, let's try to get to the green.
Wonder what Hayward's ATIS is showing right now. They're still broken. That layer is holding longer than I thought it was going to.
Is this turbulence or me just being shitty?
Mostly turbulence.
Okay, so we'll go with.
For the record, in the video, this is mostly turbulence.
Alright. Coming straight from the CFII. Is there any instances where you've flown legitimate IFR?
Nope. Well, not in the helicopter. I flew a couple approaches with Mike in the Diamond once. Or twice, a couple times. Let's keep our climb coming. We're coming up the wind farms here.
Okay.
So let's keep that airspeed right at 60.
Bravo Kilo, currently 5 miles out to the northwest, 2,500 inbound, camera park.
Did you say 60 Bravo Kilo?
Something Bravo Kilo. I didn't catch the first couple letters.
Anthony pretty good at this right about now?
He's had kind of a long break between lessons, so the last one we did was just kind of getting back into the instrument flying.
Yeah.
And once you learn it, it doesn't really go away as quickly as, you know, just flying a helicopter does when you're learning how to fly in the first place.
Yeah.
Let's turn left heading 210.
All right, left heading 210, 60 Bravo Kilo. 210.
Oh boy. I'm gonna get us away from these hills here.
Alright, please do.
Kinda getting us punched around a bunch. Careful on that airspeed, man. Yeah, that's a big nose up attitude there. Livermore Tower Helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo is 8 miles to the north, 2,500 climbing lights, transition southbound through your airspace.
Helicopter 60 Bravo Kilo Livermore Tower, transition through the Delta at or above 2,000 is approved. The Livermore Altimeter 2988.
2988 and transition at or above 2,000, 63 Bravo Kilo, thank you.
Oh. Alright, so we're almost at 210.
Yeah, I'm gonna start kind of navigating us back towards Hayward here. Usually it's, you know, when you first start learning how to fly in general, about an hour is all the useful time you get out of it.
Yeah.
I find the same kind of holds for instrument stuff. It's only really
5, 6 kilo more tower.
In about an hour.
25 right taxi via Juliet Bravo.
Especially the first couple of lessons. After that, you know, we will do like some real long cross-country flights and stuff, but
yeah.
System 05
Delta,
for right now,
125 right, clear for the
option. Short lessons is the name of the game. Alright, almost at 3,000.
Delta.
Yeah, we were just getting rocked by Mount Diablo there, I think. I still catch a little bit of it, but it should be better.
Alright, 31 Echo, contact yep. NorCal, approach on 125.1.
25.1, thanks for your help, 31 Echo.
Foxtrot Alpha, this frequency via Juliet to parking, have a good
one. Alright,
Juliet, Northeast, just about connect with you.
At 3,000, so let's level off. A little bit of collective there. There we go, alright. So we're just going to hold 3,000 and 90 knots.
Short approach approved.
Short approach approved, 05 Delta, thank you.
Hey, right, it's all trends, man. Yeah, and it's, the sooner you catch the trends, the sooner you'll be able to fix it, the easier it'll be. Yep, so go, nose forward, start to lose. You got a big
helicopter
descent.
3, Bravo, Kilo, traffic 1 o'clock and 3 miles opposite direction, Baron, altitude gates 2,500.
Say again the direction for 63 Bravo Kilo on the traffic.
63 Bravo Kilo, traffic is at 1 o'clock and about 2.5 miles opposite direction.
63 Bravo Kilo is looking. I see a strobe flashing. Let's turn left heading 180.
Alright, left heading 180.
Standard rate turn on that guy, nice, gentle. Yeah, I don't know if that light that I'm seeing is an airplane or if it's something on the ground or what.
And you could be seeing an alien invasion for all I know. I have no idea.
The joys of instrument flying. No, I'm seeing a light from a tower. I don't know where the Baron is.
I think it doesn't have ADS-B in?
I think it does. It just must not be close enough for this thing to be worried about it.
You've never flown IMC,
or not in the helicopter. I've flown in special VFR where it's like 2 mile visibility, mile and a half visibility, that sucks.
This was SFO?
That was Monterey actually.
Okay, I was gonna say SFO has that no special VFR, but does that also apply to helicopters?
It does not. That's the beauty of being in a helicopter, is we can still fly special VFR in those places. Let's keep that airspeed under control here.
Yeah, bring it down a little bit.
Better right pedal.
Bring nose down a bit.
Anytime you're making the pitch change, it's a good idea to watch this guy and just get an idea of how much input you're making. And then you can watch your altimeter and your VSI to see, okay, did I make the right amount of collective movement? And then here to confirm that you're still at your airspeed.
Does this make you a more precise VFR pilot? Or is it just a different realm?
No, I definitely noticed it in myself that, you know, after doing my instrument check ride, flying the 44 back to Watsonville, I did my check ride at Los Banos. Flying back to Watsonville was like the most straight level I've ever flown.
Right clear for the option.
05 Delta, can we make this a short approach, please?
05 Delta, short approach approved.
Short approach approved, 25 right, clear for the option.
Lima 0250 Zulu, wind 240 at 11, visibility 10. Track condition ceiling 1000 broken, temperature 17.
Alright. Let's see. We'll go a little bit further. Let's descend and maintain 2500.
Alright, 2500.
Holding short, 25 right, right turnout.
Denver 90556 Kilo, Mortara runway 25 right, clear for takeoff, right turn out approved.
Yeah, just that 3-inch right change should be enough. Keep 90 knots and get us 500 feet per minute. So much smoother over here.
Man, it's like a video game.
Yeah.
Honestly, that's what it feels like. I'm just looking at a screen, making inputs and as a reaction to.
Yeah, that's what a lot of people compare it to. Okay, so because we have our 500 foot per minute descent, at what altitude do we want to start raising our collective back?
What altitude? Right, about 100 above, 2600.
And we want 10% of our vertical speed, so 2550.
Okay.
That means if you're in a 1,000 foot per minute descent, then yeah, you would go at 2600, but we like to practice at 500 foot per minute most of the time. Every so often I'll throw in like, give me a 1,000 foot per minute descent, but if I don't specify otherwise, just assume that it's 500.
Alright, so we're getting a big descent there. Well, we way blew past it. Alright. Alright.
Remember, just keep the scan going.
Yeah.
They'll all come back. Just gotta make it do it.
Alright, so down collective.
And let's go ahead and make a right 360 back to this heading 200.
200?
Yeah.
All right.
I just want a nice standard rate turn. Should take us about 2 minutes. So we rolled in at 5235.
Livermore Tower, I'll go to 63 Rebel Kilo. Is going to make one right 360 here, and then we're going to continue out southwest now.
Look up to 3 Rebel Kilo, roger. I'm sorry, just script.
He was going to give us the altimeter again.
And aircraft making the 360, was that 5-6 Kilo?
I think that was helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo.
63 Bravo Kilo, roger. Altitude is your discretion, and departing the Class Delta frequency changes approved. Have a good day.
63 Bravo Kilo, altitude your discretion, and once we're outside of the Delta, frequency changes approved. Thanks.
Man, it's kind of
nice standard rate here.
Makes me a little bit nauseous.
Yeah.
System 05 Delta, runway 25 right. Clear for the option, short departure is approved to your discretion.
Ooh, easy there.
Clear for the option, 25 right, short field of road, short approach approved, 05 Delta.
Alright, so I'm losing altitude, so there's collective back up here. Alright.
Take us back into Hayward now.
I think there, standard turn right there. Yeah, that's a disorientation where, like, you get used to it, right? Oh.
So let's see, we rolled in 5335, so we're about a minute early, but that's all right. On the first one, we're not expecting it to be perfect. Let's go 220 on the heading. Start vectoring us back home.
220, 63 Bravo Kilo.
Kilo frequency change proof.
Frequency change proof, 5-6 kilo.
Turbulence?
Yeah, or is that kilo. We do have two aircraft over the Danville area that look to be headed this way into Livermore. Both the aircraft are at altitude gates 3,500
right, so
and 3,600.
Back quick forward.
We're going to be right here at 2,500, 5-6 kilo.
Roger.
Alright, there we go. I think I'm under control.
East of the Hayward airspace, 28 left, and we're staying at or below 1,000, 015.
Yeah, this is pretty bumpy. This is good for, you're going to get in it when, on like a normal day, and you'll be like, oh, this is so easy.
That's how that is.
Continue in mountain.
All right. Alright, down collective. Forward airspeed.
When you're rolling out of a turn, keep an eye on that guy up top, because that'll tell you when you hit your wings level. Otherwise, you're going to kind of go back and forth past it all day.
What's Hayward ATIS?
Lima. Broken at 1,000. I don't remember the altimeter.
Hayward, confirmation, Lima 0250 Zulu, wind 240 at 11, visibility 10. Track condition, ceiling 1,000 broken, temperature 17, dew point 13, altimeter 2991.
Access 12, Hayward, clearing blue, repeat, pressure, continuing in runway 28,
clearance is on
runway 2,
no pattern work available. As of above, information about high western flight service frequencies, Raj contact, you have information, Lima.
There we go, no pattern work. Interesting.
Must be because of the incident, huh?
That's the only thing I can think of. Let's turn right heading 235.
Right heading 235.
And normally, NorCal's not going to give you a heading that ends in a 5. It's going to end in a 0 most of the time. I'm just doing that so I can kind of fine tune where we're going because I can see outside.
As if I don't stare at computer screens and phone screens all day. I gotta stare at this screen.
All right, we can keep our descent coming down to 2,000 feet.
All right, so descending 2,000. Oh.
That goes 12, clearance available.
All right.
And we go right 245 on the heading.
245 on the heading. All right, so we got our heading. Got a good descent going here, got a good airspeed.
Echo 12, clear to Salt Lake City Airport via fly runway, heading until reaching 400 feet. Then turn left, heading 170.
Let's hear what he's saying right now.
Radar vectors, Altam, Linden, NS file. Maintain 2000, expect flight level 410, 5 minutes after departure. Departure frequency 125.35, squawk 3736.
That was a craft clearance. The hell is something you'll get into. That's an IFR departure clearance. So that's what you're going to get anytime you take off IFR from somewhere. So it won't do us a lot of good now until we've gone over the actual ground lesson, but that's what it's going to sound like. I'll give you your where you're cleared to, so cleared to whatever airport via the something. I'm getting ahead of myself here, sorry. We'll get to that in due time.
All right.
Okay, let's descend and maintain 1,000.
And it maintain 1,000.
Echo 12, read back correct, just advise ready to taxi.
All right.
Hey, we're Tower Helicopter 63 Bravo Kilos, about 2,000 feet over Niles Canyon, inbound for Meridian with Lima.
Helicopter 63 Bravo Kilo, Hayward Tower, make straight in for taxiway Zulu, report a 3 mile final.
Report 3 miles straight in for Zulu, 63 Bravo Kilo. Alright, so they're reporting a ceiling at 1,000 feet. That means we got to be at 500 to be our VFR weather minimums, or cloud clearance. And keep that VSI a little less aggressive there for me.
Alright.
Just a little bit.
There you go.
And we should be able to keep our descent coming all the way down to 500. I'm going to switch out glasses here so that I can see.
Yeah, we need one set of eyes, dude.
Yeah. Watch that VSI. Hey, let's turn right heading 300.
Brad heading 300. All right, start bringing it back a little bit. We're about 1,000 right there.
Justin 015,
yeah,
we're going
to come down to 500.
Oh, 500.
Yeah, we got to get underneath the cloud layer here.
Right, land on the left, 015.
Watch your heading there. Yeah, we're going to be kind of right along the hills.
If you're flying an IFR in a helicopter, you just fucked in terms of birds if they're out there?
Yep.
That's lovely.
And birds typically don't fly through clouds, from what I understand.
They only fly VFR.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, you know, it's because they're visual, they don't have instruments. I mean, they have internal organs and stuff. Let's turn left heading 285.
Left heading 285. Oh, climbing a bit. Don't want to do that. A little bit aggressive there.
And once we hit our 500 feet, I want to keep 90 knots pegged all the way until we get there. Start bringing that power back in. See a descent on the VSI for a minute after we reduce the power.
Turn right at Delta, cross runway, and you can turn right at Charlie, Cessna 015, right at Charlie, cross runway 28 right, taxi to parking via Taxi Alpha, this frequency, have a good night.
Taxi with you to parking, and we're going to cross 28 right, 015, thanks for your help.
Anytime, good night.
Anytime. Hear a lot of these sweet nothings on the radio.
Yeah, if they're really busy, it's a lot more, not terse, but shorter. But yeah, when they're real slow, everyone gets real friendly. Which apparently is like an American thing. just in general, like being friendly to strangers is like an American thing.
Really?
Yeah, like in other countries, everyone kind of keeps to themselves. Alright, so let's get just another 10 knots or so in there. Just so we get our 90 knots.
Climb. There you go.
Zulu Tower, helicopter 63, Bravo Kilos, 3 mile final Zulu.
Helicopter 3, Bravo Kilo, wind 230 and 11, taxiway Zulu, Abima Meridian ramp, clear to land.
63 Bravo Kilo Zulu, Abima Meridian, clear to land, and if you're curious at all, the cloud layer starts at about 4.5 mile final for the runways.
Helicopter 3, Bravo Kilo, thank you for the update, 4.5 mile final, and the last report I got reported at bases around 1,000, is that still correct?
Yeah, it looks accurate to us, and the tops are, I'm going to make an estimate of 1,500 or so.
Thank you.
Okay, let's turn left heading 280.
Alright, left heading 280.
That might even be a little too much, we'll have to see as we get closer. And I'll watch that altitude, because he knows that we just said the clouds are at 1,000 feet, so.
Yeah.
Watch your heading there, too.
Oh, wait.
I'm actually, I'll come on, and you can go and take the foggles off, so my controls.
Alright, your controls.
I got them.
Oh, man. Oh, alright.
Yeah, your controls.
My controls.
You got them. Alright, take us home.
Alright.
And Zulu's fucking dark.
Yeah.
There are no lights.
Whoa.
Yep. So we can start kind of decelerating a little bit. Just remember, this guy does not like to go down and slow down.
Yeah.
Now 15 inches is perfect. And now we can just kind of start bringing the nose up slowly. Our VSI is going to show a level off because we're nosing up, but we're also going to lose airspeed, and we'll let our airspeed come down to 40 knots or something like that, and then we can nose forward again. And yeah, we can go ahead a little lower on a collective now, too.
There we go.
We can make a little quick stop up here if you want. Just watching our rotor RPM as we lower the collective.
Yeah.
Okay, lights out, gauge screen feels good. We'll go ahead and walk back over to where we took off from.
All right. A chopper over there. All right. Might have to get my bearings back.
Yeah.
And this one feels calm over here after
after fucking 30 knots at Byron.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know where we're gonna go because it's. I guess it's not gonna get super low here. We can probably still go to Livermore and shoot an approach, but you know, if I'm gonna be done by 10, dude. I'm gonna be exhausted tomorrow.
Yep. All right, roll it down to 75.
And if you bring this guy right to center, that thing stops shaking. The whole instrument panel will kind of settle down.
Hayward Tower,
65.
I'm on Alpha and Foxtrot, request runway check of 28 right.
Alright, so friction.
Tower, proceed on runway 28 right for inspection.
Friction?
Proceeding on 28 right, thank you.
For inspection. You have the checklist?
You do, I think.
I've just got slippery hands. Alright. Same thing, 2 minutes.
So here's our map light up in here. It is this guy. Point that down. That's high, so. Nice. It does a little more when it's darker out, but. Dude, that was fucking loud. That's a good one.
Yeah, that was all the nausea, man. Nice puke.
I'm just picturing you opening the door and fucking hurling out the side and then closing it like nothing happened.
I'll get that on camera. Open your door.
Yeah, you reach over, open my door, and then puke in my lap. What the fuck, man?
Hey, you're leaving on the 5th.
Yeah.
Little going away prison.
Yeah.
Where's the timer?
I forgot to set it. But, so, we'll hit the PFD button. So it'll be that guy, clock timer, and then you got high clock. I don't know what that does. Oh, it's 7:40. Is that, no, that's wrong. But then you can stop, start it, you can reset it back to zero and it'll keep counting, or you can just go back.
Okay. What's PFD stand for?
Hey, we're primary flight display.
Okay, I would have guessed personal flotation device.
No.
Oh.
If we're in a boat, that would probably be the case. And we'll just do one more. When that says 1 minute, we'll do it, because it's totally spaced on the thing. Oh, yeah. Anthony's going to need these.
Got a nice level, layer of steam on them for him.
A little bit of sweat. Yeah.
Man. Roll click.
Yeah.
Alrighty. Roll click. Pull mixture. Is Anthony here?
Yeah, he said that he was he got here, so.
Oh man. Dude, that was I felt pretty pukey on the way back.
Yeah. It's a trip, isn't it?
Yeah. Alright. 30 seconds and then better break.
Yeah, and even right now you can turn the mags and the alternator off. They're not doing anything.
Because it'd be really crazy to see.
Yeah. Yeah, that one where I came up, whoa, where are you going?
Yeah. Like a toddler wandering around. Sharp corners everywhere.
Yeah, that could be your life when you get your double eye.
Seems like it's easier though, right? In that sense, like, you can see and you're just,
it's less dangerous, I'd say.
Babysitting.
And it's more mental work. Well, yeah, it's more mental than it is, physical. Like, when you're teaching someone how to hover, you're, like, guarding the controls constantly.
Yeah.
When you're teaching them how to, you're always coming on and making little adjustments and stuff. With this, I just sit here and talk. So teaching the basics of instrument flying is not particularly difficult. It's once you start teaching, hold on.
There you go, YouTube.
You get some fucking fresh air in here, dude.
That's more like turkey sandwich.
But like holding an altitude, entering a holding pattern and tracking and intercepting VORs and that kind of, that's a little more thought on my part to explain, like,
yeah,
this is what we look for and how we want everything to be set up and shooting approaches. Ugh.